Did something change on this? Usually, I think the TV is just brighter. Like, because, like, they all match. Like, everything's set the same. Oh. Yeah. That's a very... Thank you guys. You hearing the loud noises in the back? Oh, you know what? Probably be helpful if I turned up the intro music. Probably would help. Sorry for the crash. Greetings to Captain Beachy's bucket.
Interesting. What you guys can't see that we can is that our monitor that has been right there forever is now dimmer.
Wow, Scott, you are here for the beginning.
Yeah, I don't know that that's ever happened before, but congratulations, you win a cookie.
What?
It's right over here. Just come pick it up.
Just come pick it up. It'll be fun.
Wait, hold on. Nope. Yep, we're good. Hi, guys. That was exciting.
No, it wasn't.
Was.
How is it Monday and it's Thursday? How?
You guys can't see all the really awesome development and stuff going on in the studio.
That's what's fun, is it? But yeah, you guys, like, don't see it.
You guys are like, for a question on what happened, I might be able to answer if I wasn't 8 hours away.
Who did a thing? So, honestly, I think I did a thing.
Yeah, everyone just blamed Corey.
So, so we have our neck gear, but I moved it into your office when you were having a thing and having a meltdown.
It died over there.
What?
It wasn't having a... Hi, Lady Ravenous. Charlie.
Magical Leo Plural.
We set OBS up the first time that Lady Ravenous talks. The first, not OBS, Streamlabs. Every time she talks, it does the Charlie. Yes. Can we do it? We could probably do like a command.
Yeah.
A command, Lady Ravenous. She gets her own command.
Everybody's like, what about me? Does that have a cool name like Charlie?
Well, no, I mean, we could also set up that, like, yeah, no,
like alerts all the time. What's funny is I do have programmed like a mute alerts button.
Just hum.
Yeah, so as long as she talks, it doesn't sound. Okay, so there is a way to do that, Slim Bucket, but it would have to be just the first time, because every time she talks, that's gonna be too much.
No, that would just incentivize her speaking. We don't want to do that.
So we could do that to people that we don't want to talk. So, all of a sudden, if you start getting an alert, there's an alert every time you talk, you suddenly know, Kirk and Corey are telling me something.
Every time I say anything, it's like, shut up! You can do it! I'll send on Discord. Thank you, Flint Bucket. So, guys, you can't tell, I'm having a nervous breakdown as I have class today. Two assignments due that I have not started. I have a meeting. Class is at 5. I have a meeting at 3. I have a stream from 12 to 1. The funny part is that I know I'm going to pull this off. I just absolutely don't know how.
Is it a very important meeting at 3?
I could have canceled it yesterday. I could have canceled it at any point. The fact that I can't cancel it now.
Right. So.
You want to put a wig on you. You go as me.
We put a wig?
A ball cap.
Okay.
We put a fuzz cap on you. We put a fuzz cap on you, and you go, we're the same height. No one will know the difference.
No one will know the difference?
I'll just tell people I shaved. You're wearing a fuzz cap? Yep.
Gosh. We use OBS, and then we have Streamlabs. We have things that we're pulling from.
No, we do not use, we do not use Streamlabs OBS. We use straight OBS.
And then I have elements coming from Streamlabs. Not to be confused with Stream Elements.
Right. Yes. Slobs, as we have learned, is more trouble than it is worth.
Yeah.
As we've also had that vastly confirmed by basically everyone.
Yeah. Yep. So, potential of I drive you in, or rather, you can borrow my truck to drive in and I can the assignments. I can help you out with the assignments while you're driving.
Streamlabs, you can enter. All Streamlabs is it's a shell. Streamlabs is a stuffed shirt.
Yeah, but if it's...
So basically, if you build it in Streamlabs, we can import it straight into OBS. It doesn't, you don't have to use slobs to use slobs elements, so you shouldn't.
Slobs loves memory. It finds it delicious.
It finds memory delicious. It's so funny. As OBS, which is its own thing, updates, slobs, by definition, has to be reactive to that. It can't be proactive. So anytime OBS updates, anytime, there will be things, 100% something will break, because slobs now has to react to it. Mm-hmm. So no.
Yeah, I'm more thinking the Streamlabs chatbot, to be fair.
I think you absolutely can use Streamlabs chatbot in straight OBS.
Yep. All right. So today's Thursday. It's video game.
Video games. I love me some video games.
You know, this morning was all kinds of mess up and crazy to the point of my little video that I did for that I share on Instagram and our Twitter and our Facebook. No, I put it loaded up to Twitter just fine. It loaded up to Instagram just fine. I tried to upload. It's still uploading to Facebook right now. So it didn't happen for Facebook.
Ah, the book of faces. You are so reliable and dependable and not.
And not. So, it is... Yes. So, video games. Do you have the rundown?
I'm trying. I really...
I believe you. So, this is an interesting one. This is more tangentially related.
I'm in the drive. I'm not seeing it. Hold on. Don't reach out.
Okay.
Nope. Never got it. Nope. Not here. Hold on. There we go.
Okay.
I got it.
Okay. So, the World Health Organization has decided that gaming disorder is now a thing.
Tangentially related, that same organization just said that hitting the wall is that wasn't not hitting the wall. They had a better term for it, but meltdowns is a thing now. Not just exhaustion, but
a meltdown,
like a full fledged burnt out. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have overworked for too long, and it's different from exhaustion. It's you dialed it to 11 for just too long.
Interesting.
Burnout is a real... That's what it was. Burnout is a real
burnout. Huh. Interesting. So, yes. So, the World Health Organization, it's the WHO.
Tangent me. Real fast. Did you know that Peter Capaldi in Torchwood, the four-part series at the end of the four-part series of the Torchwood kind of movie-ish thing, at the end of the one season of Torchwood, Peter Capaldi played a character, this is before he became the Doctor. At that point, he'd only been associated with the Whoverse in as much as he was the Roman guy in that particular episode. He was then had a four-part series in Torchwood as a Doctor at the World Health Organization. In the credits, I kid you not, of Torchwood, he is as Doctor Who. No joke. This is before.
Did they know?
I have absolutely no idea. That's where the tin foil hat and the conspiracy theories come out. But in Torchwood, he's only ever called Doctor. I think he has a last name. Or hey, Doctor, whatever. But he's a doctor at the World Health Organization. And in the credits, it is Doctor-Who Peter Capaldi. Tangent.
That's
but
cool.
I think that's the best tangent ever.
I didn't know that.
Yep. That's why you have a nerdy co-host.
So, according to the WHO, gaming disorder, is characterized by a pattern of persistent or recurrent gaming behavior online or offline. The official description goes on to say it can include the following. Impaired control over gaming, onset, frequency, intensity, duration, termination, context. Increasing priority given to gaming to the extent that gaming takes precedence over other life interests and daily activities. And continuation or escalation of gaming despite the occurrence of negative consequences.
So here's my genuine question. And this might sound like I'm belittling this. I'm absolutely not. just described 100% of addictions. Mm-hmm. That described gambling, drugs, alcohol. So why are we get cool? Why make a whole thing where you're like, hey, did you know you could be addicted, like legit, actual, diagnosably addicted to video games? Cool. But no, they're like, hey, we've released this thing. It's gaming disorder. No, it's not. You do. You actually have a diagnosable addiction. It's interesting to me that they just described addiction, defined addiction, and gave it a new term.
Well, this is gaming specific. It's gaming addiction. It's
so call it that. We call it gambling addiction. We call it you're an addict. We have MA.
Does the WHO call it gambling addiction or gambling disorder? To the magical Google. So people who are deemed to have the gaming disorder run the risk of significant impairment to their personal, family, social, education, and occupational lives. Yes, it can be continuous or episodic in nature. Yes.
So, everywhere, I don't know about who, the who is not probably, but everywhere from the help.org to SAMHSA to Substance Abuse Hotline, everyone calls it the gambling addiction. It is gambling addiction. That is its thing. Then we have narcotics addiction, we have alcohol addiction, that's why we have NAAA, or Al-Anon more recently.
Now, Psychology Today is calling it the gambling disorder.
Interesting.
Which I believe they pull from the WHO. So, yeah.
Are we now offended by the word addiction?
So, the World Health Organization isn't trying to be offensive. Isn't trying to, yeah, like...
So the only reason they would change something is if that word has become offensive.
Right. So I'm saying there are a lot of things that the World Health Organization has declared as an official blank or whatever. They're not trying to be offensive. They're trying to help doctors. I know... I'm not talking to you.
Right.
I'm talking to tell you, like, it's
sure.
the...
But my question is, so why not call it an addiction? Are they trying to avoid the word because it is offensive? My question is still valid. Is addiction offensive?
I don't think so.
Then why are we coming up with new terms to describe an already understood phenomenon?
Hey, woman.
A disorder, I have to go, wow, what are its symptoms? If I just go, gaming addiction, oh, dude, you can be addicted to games, done, I got it. That's interesting. I'm not trying to be a jerk. I mean, I just am one. I'm genuinely curious why we're making up new generalized terms to cover something that already has a very specific definition that is synonymous with the symptoms.
I'm not sure.
Hey, Hippoman! But I still maintain that Doctor Who is behind this.
Doctor Who is behind this?
Yeah. I will say that I do know that people are bothered by the word addict. Because to describe someone as an addict, like you're
right.
Like, I don't know many addicts that are bothered by it, but I know other people that are.
Interesting. It seems to happen a lot.
Yeah, it does.
So what's really interesting, so the WHO has declared that they're going to make this a thing. It's going to be in effect and official January 1st, 2022. So ESA, the U.S. Video Game Industry Group, has responded to that, saying that the designation recklessly trivializes real mental health issues. Just like avid sports fans and consumers of all forms of engaging entertainment, gamers are passionate and dedicated with their time, the ESA says. Having captivated gamers for more than four decades, more than 2 billion people around the world enjoy video games.
Sure.
The World Health Organization knows that common sense and objective research prove video games are not addictive. And putting that official label on them recklessly trivializes real mental health issues like depression and social anxiety disorder.
Wait. Sorry, I'm not... Go back a paragraph. So they're saying that they have proven that it's not addictive.
Common sense and objective research prove video games are not addictive.
They have just invalidated everything they ever say ever again. Dopamine hits.
So it's a difference. So there's, you can be mentally addicted to anything.
Correct.
Yes. But cigarettes, nicotine is chemically addictive.
Right, but addiction is independent of what you're... So yes, with nicotine, you're addicted to the chemical.
Yes.
Actually, you're addicted to the nicotine, not the act of smoking. You can be addicted to the act of gaming.
Right.
And so, yes, you're right. There's you are not chemically addicted to gaming, other than I can actually prove that wrong. You're addicted to the dopamine. This is fascinating. I need to know what I would love to know what study this objective research and common sense they are referring to.
Right. So the, it is that there's the mental addiction where you are addicted to the dopamine, the chemical that your own brain is producing during whatever activity you're addicted to, or activity or thing or whatever,
right,
versus an outside chemical that you are addicted to.
So gambling isn't an addiction either, by that definition.
Right.
Something that has been diagnosed as a thing, this gaming company is out of hand. Well, common sense says that's not possible.
So it's the U.S. Video Game Industry Group.
Right, so the lobby...
Yes, for video games.
Right.
Yes.
So just so we're clear, the nicotine lobby is still saying that nicotine's not addictive.
Right.
So why are we talking about these people? They're stupid. I'm kidding. I'd love to know the objective research. Yeah, that's interesting. Because there is no objective research that can say that video games aren't addictive. And the fact that they double that up with common sense makes it a subjective assertion at its face. And again, this is a lobbying group with me, which means professional liars.
I mean, they have ulterior motives.
Yep.
Okay, we have a lot of... I literally am addicted to buying cards in MLB The Show. No joke, it is a financial problem I'm working on. Maybe addicted is a too innocent term today, like UFO is now UAP?
Heard UAP. Is that a German thing? I'm not trying to be funny. Unidentified airplane? I'm genuine serious. Is that what the AP is?
I don't know. Let's see. Insbuck still uses the term
retard
to slow or delay in conversation. I had a manager yelling at me about it. Yep, it's all about the dopamine rush of the gamble. Physically addicted to the dopamine or mentally addicted to the chance of winning.
Interesting concept, Lady Rabbits. I'm just going to say this. There's two books I would lead you to for fun. One's called Leaders Eat Last. It's by Simon Sinek. And the other one is called The Molecule of More. It's by Michael Long. They are both about... So Leaders Eat Last covers dopamine. The Molecule of More is specifically only about dopamine. And so what's funny about your question, physically addicted to the dopamine or mentally addicted to the chance of winning, the mental addiction is a physical addiction to the dopamine. That's what that is.
Right.
The dopamine chance that oh my gosh, I'm going to win, that energy surge, that doesn't come from nowhere. That literally is dopamine.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah, my mom, who quit smoking after 40 years, still needed to hold something in her fingers when she quit. Unidentified aerial phenomenon.
Huh. I'm about it. That one I'm okay with.
That feels actually much more specific.
It feels, because we don't know that it's flying. It could be floating, which would still be enough.
We don't know if it's an object. It could be a phenomenon.
It could be gaseous. It could be, I like that. It is so much more, by being less, it is more.
Yes. But it is not as fun to say, a UFO just is like, it's a UFO, versus a UAP. Seems less fun. It's too tinfoil hat nowadays. It's true. Like, oh, look at that UFO.
Tinfoil hats are so, so last year. We all know that carbon fiber blocks the radio waves way better, and it fits your head much more precisely.
Goodness. So, no, like,
don't we all know that? Is that not a thing? You see carbon fiber with an aluminum imbued powder, and now you can, like, you can do better. You can carbon fiber over aluminum.
No.
Moving on.
So no, like, because you can say, look at that UFO, and people are like, that's not an alien spaceship.
That's
not a UFO,
that's
like,
swamp
no.
gas. Well, cool, it's unidentified.
Unidentified.
Object. Yeah. Anomalous aerial vehicle.
Unidentified aerial system. Oh my gosh.
I use fibrous metal mesh in my hats, see?
It's military aviation. Navy.
Fibrous metal mesh. I like it. One could argue that is carbon fiber. As in carbon steel and fibrous metal, those would near be synonymous, but whatever!
The carbon fiber is specific.
It is, right.
It's specific. Oh my gosh, does that count as a tangent?
No! get it.
Okay.
Yeah. So.
Are you just making the sound of it?
Yeah. Well, and like the hey-o! Yeah. Like, you know, yeah. The gotcha kind of thing.
Gotcha.
I think it was 6 tangents. Hey, you take that back. 1 tangent.
Did I not tangent it? I don't think I did. I got distracted. I was like, what am I doing? Okay.
No. I get very touchy on, so I love words. I super duper love words. If you guys watch the show for 15 seconds, you understand. Words are literally, if you are a computer person, you're on a computer right now, so you're at least tangentially a computer person. If you are a computer person, you understand programming. You understand lines of code that shape the reality of the program. One line of code changes things. And there has been remarkable studies that I can cite, other than say common sense and objective studies, I can actually show you them, that shows you that language. Language is programming. It's social programming. And people that understand that code and understand that it's nested and multimodal, which is to say more than just the way you speak, but body language and other things, which is all forms of communication. But I get really, really touchy when someone takes a word, which means a thing, and it has a definition, and they then pervert. For example, like the word pervert, they take this definition and they pervert it. So now this word means something else. And now we can't use it for what it means because people have usurped its definition and applied things. A great example of this would be literally.
Yep.
Now we have two words that mean figuratively and no word that means literally because the actual definition of literally now means figuratively. Look it up.
Both. It means literally, both means literally and
figuratively. Because the punks at Webster, instead of saying, hey guys, stop using this word wrong, the punks at Webster are like, well, this is how it's used. I guess we should change the definition. Wrong. Incorrect. Slap your children more. And so, just like Enzovox said, the word retard literally means to slow. It's Latin-based. It means to slow. Mm-hmm. But now it's super offensive, so you can't use it. Watch the show Con Man with Alan Tudyk and Sean Astin. There's a really funny joke about this.
Terms change. Against mental disorders, you get antipsychotics today and not neuroleptics. It's the same stuff, just renamed.
Right, but that's actually my issue. It's the terms don't change for good reasons. If the terms changed because we had a better understanding, that'd be super okay. That's not what is always happening.
Usually what happens is that people will take a word and pervert the meaning, will change the meaning, use it against a group of people, and it becomes the connotation around the word disturbs the actual word. That's why there's a lot of times where I will be speaking with friends or someone, and I will say, okay, so this is the right word. It's don't think of the connotation of it, like consequence. Consequence is benign. It is neither good nor bad. It's a consequence. It can be a good consequence. It can be a bad consequence. It's just consequential of the action taken.
Sure.
But everyone thinks, oh, consequence is bad. And it's like, oh, yeah. No, it's just the consequences. Like, it's very benign.
Yeah. And no, I mean, and guys, I literally could hold on.
Oh, my gosh. Why are we...
He's posting the definition of literal. So, where, I don't know where he's getting that. So, that's the other thing is that dictionaries disagree on definitions. Because that one is the definition of literally. There are dictionaries that now say literally means figuratively.
Yeah. It's weird.
That's weird. Not this one.
Giving a word power has been dangerous all across history.
No, not recognizing that words have power has been dangerous throughout history. See how just changing the words changes the entire definition of that sentence?
But I mean...
Words have power, period.
Yes.
Giving them power doesn't give them power.
So...
Not recognizing they already did.
Giving a word that was benign a certain power is dangerous.
Fair. No, that's true. It's also, yes.
Giving a benign word a specific connotation...
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. No, that is true. But at the same time...
What is the meaning of a word? What people understand it to be, or what it originally meant? The informal definition means not literally. Used
for... I see it. More informal used to investigate a strong feeling while not being literally true. I see that now. I'm sorry.
While not being literally true, they use... Like, that's what I do dislike... Definitions that use the
And that, my friends, is the meaning of life. I'm so glad we were here to discuss that and that you all saw that in its entirety. We're back. So,
I wanted to ask if anything happened that you knew. They didn't touch anything. So.
Yeah. So basically, to just wrap up the point and say this, especially knowing multiple people that are multilingual and loving lexical gaps and the fact that words are amorphous and words are malleable, which I genuinely think they should be less so. I think that words should.
You missed what?
When we came back, I said, "And that, my friends, is the meaning of life." I'm glad we were all here to hear that.
Oh, yes. Nice.
I thought it was funny. Anyway, so words should be assigned meanings, and if we don't like meanings, we should find. So, like for example, there's this big thing in mathematics that infinities have different intents. There are different levels of infinity.
Mm-hmm.
That means that you defined it wrong in the first place. Come up with a new word. Don't change the definition of the word infinity.
That's, okay, so like that's the cool thing about infinity.
Nope, not having this conversation. I don't want you to be wrong and get embarrassed on the stream.
Okay. So did you know, if you take a number and...
No, I'm seriously not having this math conversation on the stream. Like, super duper not happening.
Okay.
And so, my whole point is that words are programming. There are actual, objective, non-subjective, not, but what is the meaning of a word? There's actual studies that are really cool, and I will happily cite them. Which will show that NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, that you can program a conversation, you can program a situation, social hacking, dynamics, using different words, using negative tense and versus positive tense, you can craft things differently.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to stop pretending like words don't matter and willy-nilly changing them and willy-nilly go, well, you know, why are we giving this word power? No, the word has power. That's called thaumaturgy, by the way, if you play some D&D. Giving something power gives it power.
Can't give you a tab until you buy something?
It's from Back to the Future.
Oh.
Hey, man, just give me a tab. I can't just give you a tab unless you buy something. Okay, I'll take a Pepsi free. You want a Pepsi, pal? You're going to have to pay for it. I just want something without any sugar. And give some coffee. Cool. Nerd rant.
Mm-hmm. Does that count as a tangent?
All of that was a tangent. So, all of that is brought to the fact that the gaming lobby is trying to tell you that somehow the dopamine from games, which has been literally proven in multiple cases and studies, isn't addictive like the dopamine in literally everything else. And so gambling is a good dopamine addiction, which is totally recognized, but gaming addiction, that's ridiculous, so we need a new word for it. I'm offended at that.
The World Health Organization is recognizing a gaming disorder as a real thing.
Because the gaming lobby has said that it is so common sense you can't be addicted.
No.
Tangentially related. Anyway, continue.
Coffee is life. You guys. It always goes back to coffee. You guys are addicted, alright?
I know you can't be. Common sense says you can't be addicted to coffee.
So, moving down the rundown?
Sure.
Sure.
Now we're going to talk about the Xbox.
Yes. So, let me see.
Just so you guys know, this whole addiction thing is going to be a theme for me for the rest of the episode.
Oh?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Okay, so, Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox, published an editorial on the Microsoft blog about the importance of diversity and committing the company to combating toxicity online. He identified three key initiatives for the Xbox team. Can you read a little bit of it?
First initiative is continued vigilance from its Xbox safety team and expanding the composition of the safety team for a greater variety of perspectives. The group of community leaders known as Xbox Ambassadors will also be working on the community missions to help create an inviting environment for players. Spencer's second initiative is to create more tools for players and community leaders to customize their level of engagement to their comfort level. Over the summer, club managers will get more moderation features, and over content moderation tools will be available by the end. More, I said, oh, yeah. And other content moderation tools. will be available by the end of 2019. It also commits to easier parental control tools, along with gaming summer camps, launching this summer to teach kids healthy habits by making them game more. Sorry. It doesn't say that last part. A recently launched For Everyone portal on Xbox keeps track of these initiatives. And finally, Microsoft, that's called an ordinal word, by the way, ordinal, which is to say tell you in what order you are speaking, ordinally, finally, Microsoft will share its safety tech across the industry, including its teams working on research, data science, and moderation. It compares this plan to its photo DNA technology, which it has shared with police and tech companies to fight child pornography. That's kind of cool. Yeah.
So, continued vigilance from the Xbox safety team. They're going to create tools for players and community leaders to customize their level of engagement, and then share its safety tech across the industry and multiple industries. So that is their threefold plan to have aggressive inclusion.
See, and I still love the term aggressive inclusion. Hashtag Bowman have not had 5-hour energy today. Boom.
You haven't had yours?
No. Interesting. This is just
They didn't hear that. He popped the mic.
This is just Kirk. Fun fact, the name of the vice president of sales of Nintendo is Bowser. I heard that a few weeks ago.
Yep.
It's so amazing.
Yeah, everyone went crazy when he got the job. It was like, oh.
And I don't have a 5-hour energy problem. Flint Bucket doesn't have a coffee problem.
Flint Bucket absolutely has a coffee problem.
I still don't have a 5-hour energy problem.
Okay.
The two are not equivalent.
You just equivocated them.
No. Nope. The equivocation only goes one way. It's like reverse osmosis.
No.
It's an asymmetry. So
yeah, just interesting that Xbox is trying to clean up. Gotta clean up your looks.
Flint Duckett doesn't have a coffee problem.
Does he have a coffee solution?
It's a coffee solution. So, again, I love the world of aggressive inclusion. It's.
In conclusion, your kids are wasting their childhood aggressively.
Where do you see that? Oh.
The best, if you look at the back of the picture of Bowser when you took the job, he had Mario and Luigi tied up behind him.
The only problem is when there is no copy. No, I will say, just in kind of, not conclusion, but continuation of
things.
I
didn't mean that. Cool, we're going with it.
In continuation is just, I think that the modern aggressive inclusion is just... CBS just rejected our copyright claim.
For fair use?
Yeah.
Great.
Hold on, I see this.
So, sorry to interrupt our show with show issues. Our Tuesday episode where we talked about TV got flagged because we showed the card trailer. Very specifically, the card trailer is getting flagged for us, and so we submitted it to.
So we appealed. It's been removed because it's been removed because you're using copyrighted material. And we're like, we're fair use. We're a news show. We're literally called Nerdy News at Noon. Fair use includes news and general commentary, which we are both.
So if you go on Facebook's like, what is fair use? They specifically, and so I use those same words, of like, they specifically said like news reporting, opinion, criticism, and commentary. So I use those in the reasoning of what it is, because that's truthfully what it is. And so the thing is that CBS rejected the dispute.
They don't get a vote. That's not how this stuff works.
So we're going to appeal the rejection, yeah?
Yeah, we are.
Oh, my gosh. We have so many more characters. I got like 100 characters last time to try to explain things.
You are otherwise... Hold on. Reason for dispute. You are otherwise allowed to use the content, for example.
That's me. That's what I... Like, that is all that I submitted. And it got rejected. So, we will deal with that after stream.
Also going to call my lawyer. Dead serious.
Cool. I'm excited. Ready for it. In other big boss news, I really put this down the rundown because I'm mini obsessed with Borderlands right now. What?
I'm so confused. Okay.
Cool. Ask your stream.
I understand. I mean, it's not going to happen. I'm going to sit here and stew over it because I don't understand why you call it public domain, which it's not.
So, okay, so let's go back.
You said you wrote that.
I wrote the explanation. The reason for dispute was a 1 of 3. So this is what I submitted. So there were 3 options on the reason.
So you didn't write this.
Correct. I wrote out the explanation.
Got it. I thought you were saying you wrote this. I'm like, this isn't accurate.
Yep. Nope.
Cool, cool.
Okay, I'm going to add a tangent. Hey, Flex Streamer. Good morning, Shifty. Sitting here thinking you were a long, long infomercial.
Yeah, no. I was going to say, and well, yeah, no, it's like it's, the minute we go down, I'm gone. So there is no after stream time.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyway, so back to the thing. So, yes, Borderlands. You were talking about Borderlands. Right?
Yes, it's okay.
Or I interrupted. I did. I interrupted.
It's okay. I'm having a weird day.
Both of us are.
Okay, so Borderlands studio executive, John Vignoki? I want to say Vignoki, because it looks like Noki, like the little potato stuff.
I'm going to call it Vignoki when we find out that it's like Vignoci. Well, sorry, but it's Vignoki.
Yes. He's been with Gearbox for a little less than a year. He's now said that he's leaving, and he's saying that he's just leaving for his dream job.
Leaving his company was one of the decisions I've had to make.
Too close. You're popping the mic.
Leaving the company was one of the hardest decisions I've had to make, and I wouldn't have done it if it wasn't for the love and support of everyone there. Vignoki said on Twitter, they understand and encourage me to take this role, as it is truly a once-in-a-lifetime.
So
he doesn't say what it is.
No. So he says it's once in a lifetime gig. It's a dream job. It's going to be a bit of a road trip. So it like he kind of is like hinting at something, but he's not saying exactly where he's going, which is just really sad because like because Borderlands 3 is coming out, which is huge and everyone's loving it. And, like,
we can't say this. That it is in the gaming industry. Like so, like Cal Penn left House. They were really House at David Shore and stuff. Like, they were pretty mean about it. Mm-hmm. They were pretty mean about it.
Gotcha.
But he left House to be a presidential appointee at the White House for President Obama. And he's like, you know what? Sorry.
Yeah.
This is like a number one show on CBS. This is a big, big show and everything. Actually, they're Fox. I'm sorry. Sorry, CBS. You don't get the credit for it. Yeah. But, you know, this is once in a lifetime. This president wants me to be a, you know, media and the arts appointee. And David Shore and them had absolutely no sense of humor, so they killed the character. Like, it went from awesome character to he killed himself. Literally. And they had him killed. It was a brutal exit to the show.
Gotcha.
They're like, fine, she can't come back. And then he did, which was amazing. Anyway, as a ghost.
Oh.
Well, as a delusion, as a fever dream. Like,
yeah.
But, so I was thinking, like, man, it must be once in a lifetime he got a chance working for Greenpeace or the Peace Corps. Or
no, it seems it's the same industry.
My favorite company in the gaming industry.
Yeah, so he's just kind of shifting around. It seems very non-loyal, very non-loyal. Working for EA, dream job, he's going to be a janitor. Yeah, so, hello, Renaissance Tinker Dork.
I love your name.
That's awesome. So, yeah, it's not saying where he's going. Working for EA, told ya.
Is he really? Do we have that? That any?
Or was that a response to, he's going to be working as janitor, told ya, EA.
Okay, so, back to, I was just about to read something and then it disappeared on me. It's interesting, that's not what I meant to open this. This. Love you, JB. So everyone seems to be. Here are my thoughts.
Everyone seems to be happy for him.
Here are my thoughts. It feels to me. This is so. This story is truly exactly what it says, just, like, really weird. Like, really, like, holy crap, this stuff happened. I'm really sorry I just got here, but blah, blah, blah. Or there is an insanely large amount going on here that isn't being said.
Yep, that's definitely an option.
Like, I can think of several different scenarios. My carbon fiber hat is not on at the moment, so, like, I'm getting full radiation.
Uh-huh.
I can think of a lot of where, like, in the military, we have this thing where promote someone out of it. Like, if you really hate your leader, firing someone in the military is really, really hard. Really hard. Mm-hmm. Promoting them's not. But if a job is for a certain rank, and you don't like someone,
okay. You
recommend them for promotion, because then they have to leave. But now they're elsewhere with a higher rank, and this happens a lot, where suddenly you see this idiot who's like a colonel, and you're like, how? How did this even happen? You're like, yeah, everyone
just trying to get them out of the way.
Just threw them on the escalator, like, here, you go off and slay some dragons, sir!
Now, I have a really big problem of people getting promoted into managerial, positions, and they have no interest in managing people. They do the job really, really well, and then they get promoted to this supervisor position, and then they don't get to do the job anymore. Because usually the manager gets less hands-on with the actual job,
yep.
And so then they're unhappy because they're not doing the job that they love to do and are amazing at. You've lost an amazing worker and someone who isn't talented in managing people, like...
What's funny is when I joined the military, it was the exact opposite. Well, it was that exact same thing, but backwards. I, with a college degree and two children, enlisted, and my dad, a career colonel, was like, what are you doing? What are you doing?
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm enlisting. And he's like, why? He's like, because I want to do things. He's like, I got to do things. He's like, no, you got to manage people doing things. There's a big difference. You got to supervise and oversee. You got to... And now I will say that in the four years that I was enlisted, before becoming an officer, I got my fill of it, I got my feel for it, and then when I became an officer, it was specifically, ironically, to do things, because I found that it was the officers who didn't know anything that were incredible. Like, and specifically, I was in a unit, and I was a cameraman in a public affairs unit, and my commander had gotten promoted out of, he was infantry, had nowhere to go, kind of hit this glass ceiling. So he got his promotion by jumping over to public affairs, where the fact that he could barely craft a sentence together. And so all of a sudden he's giving us messaging and videos to do, and I'm like,
why?
No.
Who are you?
He's like, well,
Who even are you?
Like,
U.S. military falling upward since, by the way, not a knock on our freedom.
Yeah, no. Crap, I may have just angered everyone. No. Yeah, no.
It's okay, he did it first.
I did it first. You know, so I had both... I also, because I'm in the reserve, I also had a upper level sergeant who was a career police officer. Nothing against police officers. So, like, I'm here really low ranked. I'm a media professional. I own a media company. I own tens of thousands of dollars of equipment. I do this every day. And I get into work, and my sergeant is a police officer who, with a handy cam, and likes to make home movies. And my commander is an infantry guy. And both of them, I'd go and like, hey guys, so this isn't going to work. And I was told to sit down, shut up, and do what I was told. I was like, cool, so I'm going to become an officer.
Because, no. I'm pretty sure most of the people here are not American.
That's true. I'm pretty sure it's just you and me, Bowman. No, and Shifty. You don't count. You and us, Bowman. And Shifty. And I don't know about Renaissance Tinker Dork. That really could go either way.
Yeah. We should go to the Renaissance Festival. We should just twitch it.
Hard pass.
What?
No, I'm looking. Yeah, Bowman, it's just us. Other than I don't know about Renaissance Tinkerberg, everyone else I know where they are.
Like, you guys are just Southern Canadian.
We did cover that the other day.
Aggie, right?
Aggies, yeah. The agricultural hall needs agricultural music.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yes, I recognize that. I did. What is that? Is that a squirrel? Is a
Tinker
Renaissance
Dork
squirrel?
Does sound relatively Canadian, unless he's not Canadian, in which case I'm sorry for insulting you by calling you Canadian.
Dude!
You are Canadian, calling you Canadian was totally not an insult. What? It's an armored squirrel.
Uh-huh. Look at that, guys. Look at the detail. Holy crap. Look at that. It's a is freaking rad. Thank you, by the way, for giving me that.
What?
Freaking rad. That is not a thing I've ever said before hanging out with you and Natalie.
Technically, I'm American. Freaking so either you...
Oh, Jesus!
Easier. No, you're a hobbit.
From America?
From Middle Earth.
Isn't that America?
I live in Boulder, Colorado. Well above Boulder, anyway.
So it's Colorado.
Yeah.
And Oompa-Loompa, so he's from the Wonka Factory.
From the Wonka Factory in Middle Earth.
Where did he say he got the Oompa-Loompas from?
Loompa-Land.
But didn't he say he went to a country to get
Loompa-Land.
In a continent? Sorry.
I don't remember that. He said, he's like, they're from Loompa-Land. And he said, there's Loompa-Land, there's no such place. He's like, I beg to differ, madam. Like, no, he's absolutely...
Okay.
I am a teacher of geography. Then you know all about it. And how little Oompa Loompas were being eaten up by the very pernicious canids.
Speaking of, I need to give them bucket 2 keys.
Cool. More Americans. America.
Yes. That started the Great Armored Squirrel Civil War of 2019.
Anyway, I saw a black squirrel the other day.
What?
Well, because I've seen gray squirrels my whole life. Those are the common tree squirrels. I've seen red squirrels, which are more common to the southwest. They're red, they have bushier kind of... I've seen red squirrels and gray squirrels my entire life. I've seen a few albino squirrels, but that's not a species. That's a genetic aberration. So where was I? It wasn't here. It was months and months ago.
Gray squirrels are the big fluffy ones.
Gray squirrels are what we have here. Yeah. Red squirrels are whatever you've seen. If you've seen a squirrel, it was a gray squirrel, probably. Here in the southwest, might have been a red squirrel. I've seen albino squirrels. I saw a pitch black, like coal dust black squirrel. It was freaking rad. Yeah.
Freaking rad. We should have a freaking rad counter. Like, oh, so you won't know. Maybe you guys do. Jenna Marbles on YouTube, she always says, hell yeah. So, but like, she should have a, we should have a
deploy. Okay, so incidentally, Kirk, I serve in the Colorado Army National Guard, for those who are curious what I speak military, so I'm currently in the Army Reserve, just so I've been in since a minute. I enlisted in 2011.
How do you say it? How do you pronounce the word? The flim bucket word.
Repost?
Nope. The flim bucket word.
I'm looking at it. I don't know.
Is it?
Deployed in 0607 as a cook, man. So... Cooks are both awesome. Like, my hat goes off to you, sir. So real quick, this is me just talking to Renaissance and Tinkerdor for a second. The rest of you can listen, but this is a joke between me and him, and he'll get it.
Okay, and then I have a story.
Okay, he'll get it. No one else will. So when I commissioned from an E4 to an O1, I got a direct commission from a 3-star general. That's a story in and of itself. No, I'm not made of shit. I'm dead serious. I got a direct commission from a 3-star general, General Tally. If you were curious, he was the chief of the Army Reserve at the time. Anyway, so I went from an E4, where I was an E4 for almost 5 years, and then I became an O1, and I wanted to write a book, which I was somewhat kidding. So I wanted to write a book called Confessions of a Butter Bar. He gets it. If you don't, DM me. Called Confessions of a Butter Bar. And chapter one, pretty much, there was only going to be about 4 chapters. Chapter one was about the fact that, as an E4, when you sneak into the kitchen to steal cookies from the cooks, you leave with both cookies and a sense of accomplishment. That's, you get out of there with your fistful of Oreos or Hydrox, as they end up being more often than not being. You leave with your, like, your pocket full of Oreos or Chips Ahoy or whatever. You're like, yes, I'm a ninja. When you go into the kitchen to steal cookies as an O1, you get a, hey, sir, would you like a cookie? And then you just leave with a cookie and the feeling of being a fat ass. That's the difference between getting cookies as an E4 and an O1.
Gotcha.
Again, that joke was for you, Renaissance Digger.
Dying laughing.
That's the difference. Like, when you walk into the kitchen, like, hey, oh, sir, would you like a cookie? I'm like, yes. You're like, that's why I'm here. Anyway, so that's the difference. Confessions of a Butter Bar. There you go.
Nice. I tangented that.
Yeah, you should have. That was a total tangent. But I see, he liked it, though.
Yeah.
Totally, yeah.
Totally about it.
Yeah.
It's true.
Steal cookies. Like, yes, I got cookies, and I'm a ninja. Yes. Like, no. But as an O1, they're just like, sure, would you like another cookie? How about I get you some milk? I'm like, stop it.
Tell me to heat it up and froth it.
I used to totally piss people off. Like, I used to, one battle drill, I had literally nothing to do. I was a platoon leader. I had 30 soldiers. Mm-hmm. I was the platoon leader, and the cooks had kind of a problem that month. There was no one. And my platoon was all, like, squared away. I had nothing to do, literally nothing to do the whole weekend. So I walked into the kitchen, and they only had one cook. And I walked in, he's like, hey, sir, can I get you something? I was like, yeah, have a seat. He's like, what? I was like, I'm making food this weekend. He's like, what?
Did you screw with him?
No. I mean, I was like, tell me what to do. And he literally, he kept trying to get up to help. I was like, you sit the hell back down. You're taking it easy this weekend. I am making the food. So I made food for 130 people.
Yeah.
It was chili mac. It's really hard to screw up. But like, no, but,
yeah.
But that's not my point. No. The point is like, it was fun. There.
So when I was at, when I was on set this past summer in Texas, so I was both on locations and craft services, but as kind of locations and craft services, we also hired the cook for breakfast and lunch. So they were kind of like under my purview. I took care of them, made sure they were okay. And this guy, he was not used to this. He was not used to like cooking for this many people. He wasn't used to like, my uncle was very, so my boss was very distinct about like, it needs to be good food. It can't be, it can't be bought at Costco, and like it needs to be presented well, it needs to be nice, it needs to excite the crew, because it's food. I mean, like, it should be good food. And he kept, like, not doing it. We kept being like, okay, man, like, we just gotta stretch a bit of a notch, and like, he would like, make way too much, and then he would like, make too little, and like, he was the nicest, I mean, this was Texas, he was so nice. Hey, Jamar, thank you for subscribing.
Better late than never. We're going off right now.
Right now.
But thank you for the subscription.
Yeah. Okay, bye, Bowman. We're going off soon. We're going off soon. But no, he was so nice. And just every day, like, we'd be like, okay, so there's a lot left over. And he'd be like, dang it. And then next day, he'd, like, make something that everybody loved and wanted seconds, and he didn't make enough. And he was like, dang it. Like, he was so, oh, man, flustered. It was so rough.
The thing is that cooking for a lot of people is only hard if you don't have my stomach, which is to say I don't think I've ever actually been full. That is a feeling that people are like, man, I'm so full.
They,
I'm like,
they were tight. Like, they couldn't make so much food, and, like, it felt wasteful.
I will say, though, the best food I've had in my life, and I've eaten at nice, expensive restaurants, the best food I've had in my life is on set. Mm-hmm. Set food is no joke. Yeah, you're eating on a Chinette plate sitting in a gravel lot, but dang, it's amazing.
It was pretty good. Hi, JoJo. Okay, virtual confetti. Woohoo! Cooking for lots of people is hard. Yeah. Cooking for one is harder. That's
true. I mean, unless it's like a steak and salad. Because the steak, you're going to make one steak.
No, but see, the salad, because they sell everything to make a salad, is sold in such big portions, right? So, like, my salad bag can probably do two salads, but my tomatoes is probably enough for three, and it's all the wrong portions. Mom's girlfriend made meatloaf and said that because she put onion soup mix on it, she didn't need onion in it.
First off, ew.
Also, Lady Ravenous, no, we're not doing the slime. We're not doing the slime. No, we're not.
Okay. We're totally not going to do that. See, I don't want it to be slime, because that'll hurt my equipment. But the plan, for those that missed the show we're talking about, what you don't see is that just today we set up, we now have a grid above our head. We haven't had that in our last space. We now have the ability to rig different lighting sets, and we have a whole sugar madoo over our heads now. Sugar madoo, totally a word.
Sugar madoo.
Sugar madoo.
The thing is that you couldn't surprise me with slime because I'd see it.
No. So what I want to do is I want to rig automated buckets that are above our heads with drop-out things and fill them with, like, confetti.
But, like, fat confetti,
but
not
like
glitter.
Like, sequins-y,
like,
confetti.
You can sweep it up, confetti.
And then they're just above our heads, and we'll have like a tip bucket thing. And every so many whatevers, ever so many whatevers, literally, you could like hash, you know, glitter bomb Kirk, glitter bomb Kirk. And of course, there will be a cost associated with this. We gotta make some money here because we're running out of it.
That's true.
Fast. But like, so it's like 1980, 1990, Nickelodeon. You can't do that on television. But instead of slime that'll hurt my computer, it's confetti. And frankly, that's funny.
Do a show sitting in the rigging dressed as Batman, some other bat person, just like in the comics.
I'm about it.
We could do that. Anywho. Yes. We're probably gonna make that happen. What's gonna be scary is that, like, if we just don't announce it and we just wait until the next, like, subscription happens, and it happens, everyone's all surprised. What? Like, if we had already had set up and Jabbar had subscribed.
The thing is, it has to be a, like, it would need to be a semi-legit amount of money.
Yeah.
It would need to be, like,
every show. That's a lot of sweeping.
It can't be every show, unless, like, we're talking, like, $100.
Yeah.
Not, like, every time someone donates $100, but, like, every time our bids get to $100, or every time the donations hit a certain amount, it would need to be
a big one, yeah. We're trapped.
No, it can't be. No. Hurt my computer.
No.
Like, now, yes. For the record,
$10,000 for slime.
Done.
The crystal maze style. Oh well.
So here's what we're gonna do. Come middle of summer. No, you'll be gone. Never mind. We could do a show where the entire show was us in a dunk tank. Like, we could rent dunk tanks.
Yes.
We could rent dunk tanks, put shotgun mics over them, and do the entire Nerdy News with us sitting on different dunk tanks, and like Nathan, like, and there could be just like a, every so often someone just dunks us. For the record, that sounds amazing.
We should do that.
We need to find out how much it costs to rent a dunk tank.
We can do that off air. We can do that. Okay, so who can we raid over to?
Yeah. Oh, it's Thursday.
Okay, then that answers that question. Let me make sure that they are there. Yep. Oh, I got an ad. Or they're just starting? I think they're just starting.
We've never gotten them.
Oh, fancy.
Yeah. Hey, so we are going to be raiding over to Andrew at the Level Up Show. We love him. His show is just like ours. Ours is better.
Whoa!
I didn't say that.
Corey freaking out. Yeah. I know a guy with the dunk tank.
In the area?
Jabbar.
Oh! It was like, I thought someone in Canada was saying that. I was like, congratulations. But Jabbar is saying that. We need two.
We just need one with two.
No. I'll just sit outside of it. You'll sit inside of it. Okay, guys, vote. Who wants to see you? Who wants to get.
You're taking a dang turn. Are you kidding me?
Who should get dunked?
You're taking a freaking rad dang turn. In the dunk tank. Flint bucket, but you're in Canada.
We need to cover this again. Geography, it matters.
Did you already hit go?
I thought I did.
Yes, you did not.
No,
hashtag Dunkirk. Lady Brevin has charged me someone's head. Okay. But I could come there and build you one. Dude.
Okay, guys. So everyone, go raid Andrew. Give him the love. Watch the show. Ours is better.
Today was video games. We
talked about a video game.
Yeah. Tomorrow is movies again for Friday. And yeah, we'll see you guys soon. Hopefully tomorrow morning it's not as crazy.
Yep. Bye.
Kirk is a hobbit.
First off, I'm 6'2". The world's tallest hobbit. I'm like a Gaiman-sized leprechaun.
Yes.
Talk to you later.
Bye, guys.